Good evening. My name is Neil Jenman, for those of you who didn't know, and tonight's presentation is called The Inside Secrets of Real Estate. And I'm aware that when you come up with a title like Inside Secrets, that it's a title that can perhaps lead to disappointment. People say, oh, well, yes, I know that already. In fact, when I'm writing, I've got a little sign in front of me that my wife told me. She gave me a message one time, and it meant so much to me that I keep it stuck in front of me, and it says, tell them something they don't know. And I think when you speak to people in real estate today, most of the time they give you, particularly with buying or selling your family home, they give you the standard cliches about it's always a good time to buy real estate always goes up. And I think there could be a meteor headed for your suburb, like sort of like out of the movie Armageddon, and real estate agents would still generally tell you you should be buying quickly. Now, I'm not going to tell you that. What I am going to tell you tonight is what goes on behind the scenes in real estate. I'm also going to show you that you needn't be as worried and concerned about real estate as a lot of people might be, that it really is quite a simple process, that generally it's only the tricks and the traps that are complicated. And once you can see your way through those, that you'll be perfectly okay. This evening's session is kind of like in two parts. The first part is to do with buying and selling a family home, and the second part is to do with investing in real estate. You're not going to probably remember every single thing that I say this evening. If there are just three words that you would remember that I would say, if I had my choice about which three you could remember, they would be those words, don't sign anything, that have been playing on the screen there for the last half an hour or so. I've put them in so many different languages because I don't want anybody to forget them. When I started in real estate, so much of what I did was done on a handshake. So many of the people that you used to meet, you'd shake hands. And I have to say that the handshakes that we used to have meant a lot more today than some of the things that we sign. Today, it doesn't seem to matter what gets said. It's what you sign that's important. I'll be a little firm about some points. And the reason for that is that people have actually been to this presentation and gone out, left here, and gone out and got themselves ripped off. Only because they signed something. So there is nothing tonight for you to sign. There is no money for you to pay. There's going to be no slides going on the screen showing you how you'd better hurry up and buy in southeast Queensland before the boom finishes. None of that. I also think it's important that I tell you that I'm not the world's most perfect person. I have lots of flaws and lots of faults, like I think probably all of us do, and sometimes I have more than others. I'm not out to say that every real estate agent in Australia is crooked. Some of the worst real estate agents I've ever met in my life have been those that have claimed to be associated with me. I had my own real estate office in the western suburbs of Sydney for about 10 years, and I went to the training courses, and I wanted to learn what to do, and I didn't like what I was being told. I didn't like a lot of what I was being taught. So I questioned it, and pretty well I found myself isolated, shut out. So I used just two principles, and that is look after your customers and work hard. And I did pretty well, and that led to me teaching other real estate agents and going around Australia. And that's my only source of income today is actually from teaching real estate agents, but because of my outspoken views, I've lost a lot of real estate agents as clients. I'm not probably real estate's most popular person. But I still have never lost faith in the fact that if you look after your customers, the mums and dads, the people who own the homes, and real estate is the biggest business in this country today, if you look after those, in the end, everything's going to be okay. About 5 years after I started teaching real estate agents, I got so upset at some of the things that I saw that I made a public comment. I said that I believed that 50% of real estate agents were crooks. And one of the things that you are not allowed to do in the real estate industry, it's a big no-no, and that is criticize the real estate industry, particularly publicly. So I was asked to apologize. And before I do anything on a grand scale or make any big statement, I think about it. And I thought for a couple of days about what I was going to do because they weren't going to come to my courses anymore. And I might lose my income, so therefore my livelihood depended upon it. And I remember a line that I heard a long time ago. It it's okay to get paid, but don't let people buy you. And I thought, maybe I'm being bored if I think like that. So I released another statement. I said, okay, I believe that 50% of the real estate agents in Australia are not crooks. And from that point onwards, there was kind of no turning back. And I have been a student of literature all my life. I love literature and philosophy. And Jerome Wideman, who was an author, an American author, who was an acquaintance of Somerset Maugham, once said, you know, if you're going to ruffle the apple cart, you know, rock the boat, or what is it, ruffle some feathers, rock the apple cart, no point going halfway, you may as well go all the way. So I decided I would go all the way. I've got a lot that I can share with you, and in the time that we have, you may think that 10 past 10 is like, gee, that's late, or that's going to be pretty late. But I can assure you the time will go pretty fast, and I have to grab, what do I show you that I have? I thought I'd start off by giving you some examples of what you get told publicly and what actually happens privately, and I'll show you a few of those. But one of the things I wanted to show you was that something that happened in Sydney at the start of this year, not to do with Shane, but this one here. On the front page of the Sydney Sun Herald was this headline: how much your property will rise in value this year. It didn't say it with any doubt. It said it as a matter of certainty, how much your property will rise in value this year. The same weekend was this headline in the same Fairfax paper: prices fall as the frenzy fades. So what is the situation? How do we know, for example, when a real estate market is too high? What keeps it going? And I can assure you that what's kept the current Sydney real estate market going has been something akin to the strawberry box principle of investing. And I'll speak about that when I talk with you about investing after the break. But just in case I forget, I'll continue down that line now, because what I do, even though I do this talk many times, I do it differently every time I do it. Not because I don't want it to be boring, not necessarily for you, but for me as the speaker. So the strawberry box, and I tend to get a little Ronnie Corbett-ish sometimes, so if I forget where I am, I might get you to remind me. But the strawberry box principle works like this. It's the box of strawberries that keeps getting sold over and over again for higher and higher prices, until one day somebody opens a strawberry box and says, these strawberries are all rotten. And the person who's selling the strawberries says, oh no, they're not for eating, they're for selling. And that is currently what you have in today's real estate market. Just very, very quickly, how can prices keep going up by 25, 30, 40% when wages are going up at 5 and 10%? It's kind of common sense that we are running out of money to pay for it. But I'll get into that, and I'll show you some of those things as well. But when you're out there, how do you pick who's a good agent and who's not a good agent? The people who run the real estate industry, they'll all tell you that their agents are perfect. And I teach agents, and as I said to you, I can assure you that some of those are not perfect. And when I close this evening, I'll show you how I believe redress should apply in the industry. But there are people at the heads of franchise networks, there are people at the heads of real estate institutes. In fact, here is an advertisement that says, is your agent a member of the real estate institute? Now, I have a very interesting question, and because my critics will often say, look, he doesn't really have any qualifications, I'll go, yes, well, that's why I have to kind of talk really simply. The same as when I go to a doctor, I'll ask, he mightn't be qualified as a doctor, but if I've got a pain, I'll say, look, I'm qualified to know that this is hurting. So let me show you a couple of things. You might recall a couple of years ago, I think it was about 3 years ago actually, there was a scandal that broke out in the eastern states of Australia about real estate agents who were following up death notices in the newspapers. And in case you don't recall it, I've got the headline here that said, when death comes knocking, so does the real estate agent. Well, what is the real estate industry's response to this sort of thing? Well, it's general. It kind of all works the same. In New South Wales, the president of the Real Estate Institute said the agent couldn't be punished because he wasn't a member of the institute. I see. Another CEO said, I am appalled by this alleged conduct. And they like to use the word alleged as if the widows and widowers were lying about it. They were just making it up. I believe it's isolated. That's another word that gets used a lot by the spin doctors in real estate. If we do find it's happening, we can fine members, expel them, or require them to undertake a training course. Now, that's interesting, because a couple of days after that comment was made, I sent somebody into the Real Estate Institute to purchase this manual, which is published by the Real Estate Institute of Australia. And inside the manual It's got 69, I think it is, ways to follow up death notices, to follow up, and method 44 is follow up death notices. There it is. Method 59 for finding new business is visit nursing homes and retirement villages. Mm-hmm. I actually am pleased to say that that manual that I have in my hand here, I believe has now been withdrawn. So even though they mightn't pay me any sort of like public attention, or I know in New South Wales their general line is no comment, when I'm in town they batten down the hatches and just put out the hurricane shutters and that's it. But I believe that has been withdrawn. I've actually got in my hands here, and a slide was made of it, but I considered it too distressing. I've got a letter here written by a real estate agent with the death notice pinned to the top left-hand corner, written to the widow of somebody who's just lost their husband. And it says, "Dear Mrs. So-on," it says, "as per the details from the newspaper, we notice that you are the executor of this estate." But then it goes on and says, "We hope this letter has not arrived at a sensitive time. But if you are in need of a comprehensive appraisal of the deceased's property," and then it goes on, "if you're offended by this letter, ignore it." Now, I'm not saying everybody does this, and I know lots of real estate people would be appalled, but as I'll show you later on, what actually happens when that gets done? I know it's isolated or it's alleged. I had a fellow who left our company recently because he said that the biggest obstacle to profit in the Genman Group was Neil Genman. So he left. He's now gone to work with a rival training company, and this is some of the stuff that they issue. 50 ideas to rev up your sales. Market yourself, not your properties. Nobody buys a house from a classified ad, or very few people do. Probate, deaths, and divorces. They're a great source of leads. When dealing with sellers, use market feedback to bolster your case. And in a hot market, don't be afraid to underprice. Now, in fairness to real estate agents, it's a very, very competitive industry. Real estate agents, particularly when the boom's on, wherever you look, you'll find a real estate agent. And real estate agents, the way they get paid is they get paid by the sellers. And you home buyers this evening are going to understand why it is that when you've got $400,000 or $500,000 to spend, you get treated far, far worse than if you're spending $4 or $5 in a milk bar. You'll understand, because what the agents want more than anything else are home sellers, because it's home sellers that pay their commission. And when they get a home seller and get the home seller signed up, it's called a listing. Now, there are three topics that are not discussed, well, very not taught, really, in the real estate industry. Those three topics are negotiation, ethics. They say they teach ethics, but I can assure you they do not teach ethics. I was on ABC Late Night Radio with Tony Delroy about 12 months ago, and the man who was on with me was the CEO of one of the institutes, and he was saying that they teach ethics. And I thought, be kind to him. And I thought, if he keeps going down this path too much more, I'm going to do it to him. So I did. I asked him what the meaning of the word ethics was, and he couldn't answer me. But I thought, you said you teach ethics. Ethics is a system of moral principles by which human actions are judged right or wrong, good or bad. That's what ethics is. That's the dictionary definition. And the first principle of ethics comes from the Latin, which is primum non nocere, which means first do no harm, don't hurt anybody. It doesn't say that because you're acting for the seller, it's okay to have a dummy bidder. That's not ethical. But nevertheless, ethics is something that is not taught. Nor is marketing. Marketing to real estate agents is just putting out advertisements. Advertisements is not marketing. Real estate agents, as you know, in their search for listings, will be putting flyers in your letterboxes and calling you up and doing all sorts of things. And I thought I'd give you some examples. And this first one comes from the largest real estate organization in the world, a company called Century 21. And this is a flyer that they put out called "Come in and talk to the big boys of real estate," because they're the biggest in the world, you see. And they actually put an image on. This shows you an example of what they know about marketing. They put an image on the front to endear themselves to you, the home sellers. There they go. Want to sell your property. They're all trying to be different. Everybody's trying very hard to be different. For instance, who said all real estate agents are the same? Well, this fellow, of course, he's totally different. And there's another one here, Leo. And his advantage, if you call him, he's house trained. Which means that at least you know your carpets are going to be safe. I saw this one in Melbourne last week and I thought it was quite cute and I quite like this fellow. I thought he looked good. For big results, deal with the biggest in the business. Now, I like the one on the left, but I'm not sure about what he's got in his hand on the other picture, but never mind. In Melbourne as well, in some of the high market areas, a little more sophisticated. And here's a good one. It says, outstanding in his field. Is that a donkey? No, I mean on the left, on the right. Sorry, I'm looking from a different position here. And I was in Port Macquarie, and I thought I would have to get these people in if I was selling my home. I really would. The only thing missing from this next one is the theme from Bonanza. Have a look at this, will you? This is pretty good. I like this. Here we go. There they go. You can just hear it, can't you? Yep. You see, they all want you to call them in. They all want you to call them in so that they can give you a price on the sale of your home. Now, let me show you how hard it can be to be a real estate agent. Let's say that your home is worth $500,000 and you call out an honest real estate agent. The honest agent says to you, I think your house is worth $500,000. And what you should do is you should always get 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 10 different quotes. Let me promise you something, that if you own a home and you are thinking of selling it, you are a very, very powerful person before you sign. All right? You can get the real estate agents to jump through hoops, and really you could. You could get some of those hoops and actually say, I will give you my house for sale if you will jump through the hoops. And some of them would do it. As your confidence increases, I actually thought of this the other day, you could light the hoops and some of them would still go through it. The honest estate agent, anyway, you say to the honest estate agent, look, thank you very much for coming. I'm glad you told me my home's worth around about $500,000. We've got somebody else coming later. The next person to lob up in the black two-door Beamer that parks across the driveway is, let's call this one, Larry the Liar. Larry pulls up and he gets out and he's got his double-breasted black suit on and the oily look and walks up the driveway. And if he was coming to date your daughter, you probably wouldn't let him near the place. But you see, this is business, isn't it? And it's amazing what we do in business. The other night in Melbourne, I actually talked about a financial planner who's a rogue and his name's Paul Murphy. And later on, I got an email from a man who I didn't realise till I looked at his email address, he was with the police. Now, I wrote back and I said, when I interviewed Murphy for my book, I said, he oozed sleaze. Didn't you pick this? And the cop emailed back. He said, oh yeah, my wife said exactly the same thing, but we thought all financial planners were like that. No, please. There are some clues there. Anyway, Larry comes into your home and he's walking around. Actually, you can pick the real estate agents in the audience. You know, those that have snuck in pretending to be consumers, and good evening to you as well. Because you're not smiling. You're giving me some filthy looks. And also, those of you who've got recording devices, I just want to tell you, please don't hide them under your jackets. You're welcome to hold them up, okay? Because everything I say tonight, I wanted to get out as much as possible. In fact, I'm happy to walk around with your tape recorder and I'll speak into it for you. Anyhow, Larry, you say to Larry, Larry, what's my house worth? And Larry says, oh, gee, I don't know. This market, the way things are going at the moment, put it to auction, you might get $3 million for it. Now, what you do, of course, is you don't like Larry, but you like the words that are coming out of Larry's mouth. And let me tell you psychologically, and this is an absolute truth, if you want to catch somebody, if you want to trap somebody and have them believe your lies, all you do is tell them what they want to hear. You try it. You try when you go to work tomorrow, you say to some people, gee, you're losing weight. And I say, oh, really, am I? Thank you. Okay? You think about this, men, when your wives come back from the hairdresser. If you don't like it, okay, what do you normally say? Gee, it's looking great, isn't it? It's very nice. Some of you don't even notice, which is really worse, of course. But you see, if you tell somebody something that they want to hear, they tend to believe you. So when Larry says, look, it's very hard to tell in this market, put it to auction, you might get $550, $600. You know what you're tempted to do? Sign on the dotted line with Larry. And then the honest real estate agent watches, and he watches you go through the process. You then go through the hoops. You go through the pressure. And then he watches your house get sold for $480,000 or whatever the figure might be. Let me tell you that this has become so endemic, this business of giving false quotes to sellers, that I'll give you a statement from the Real Estate Institute in Victoria that says, it's a market reality, agents, that you have to overquote or lie to get the business. It's a market reality. What they want you to do is they want you to sign one of these. And this is a form, and I'll show you the... I couldn't believe it. If you think it's hard to read there, you want to try reading it up close. The minimum you're allowed to have by law is 6-point print. Doesn't say anything. I thought there was a misprint when I actually saw these, which were the new ones that were issued about 12 months ago. When I saw these, I thought there must be a mistake, that I must have a faded copy, so I went and got a whole batch of them, and they were all the same. The new ones, I'm pleased to say, that have only just come out, are a little bit, just a tad more clear. But it doesn't matter. They want you to sign one of these, and I can assure you that this document that I'm holding in my hand, which is called a selling agency agreement, is designed to protect one person, the real estate agent. It's designed by real estate agents, and it's designed to protect the real estate agents, not the consumers. I haven't seen this ad running for a while because I challenged them, and maybe they've stopped it, but this used to say, our ethics and rules of practice guarantee your protection. Yep. And in the dictionary, the word guarantee is to protect or indemnify, and indemnify means to compensate. Well, when somebody got aggrieved, in the end, I got so sick of seeing that ad, I said, write to the Real Estate Institute and tell them I want to claim on this guarantee. And I got to hand it to the Institute. They wrote back very quickly, and they said, the Institute has no power to award compensation against its members. The lady then wrote immediately back and said, why do you advertise a guarantee if you don't have a guarantee? And that was 2 years ago, and she still hasn't got a reply. But anyway, once you sign one of these, once you sign something like this, you then have to go through a process. Crocodiles, they can't chew. I read this in John Gordon Davis's novel called Hold My Hand, I'm Dying. I was away with my wife on holidays and I was reading this book. She said, what are you reading about? I said, I'm reading about real estate agents. She said, but that's not what it says. I said, no, it talks about crocodiles. She said, well, what's the analogy you have here? I said, well, here's the analogy. A crocodile grabs its victim in its mighty jaws and drags the victim underwater and holds the victim there until such time as the victim drowns. Now, there'll be a lot of activity going on. The victim, of course, will be thrashing around trying to get away. The crocodile is very, very strong, powerful, and will perhaps go into a crocodile role. But note, the crocodile's too strong, and the victim will drown. The crocodile will then take the victim away and leave the victim in its den to rot for several weeks so that the crocodile can come back later and crunch off pieces and swallow and digest them more easily. Now, this softening up process is the nature of crocodiles and real estate agents. And in real estate, it's called conditioning. And there's two parts to it. There's the activity conditioning, and then there's the crunch conditioning. And if you don't believe that it's called conditioning, it's actually taught. Vendor conditioning, it's called. Vendor conditioning. And here's what's said. Your strongest position in the selling process, agents, is 1 second after the vendor, that's the seller, has signed the listing authority. Don't wait for 6 weeks to give them the bad news. Start giving it to them straight away. Now, I was reading this and I was learning this when I was doing my real estate courses. And remember that what I'm showing you tonight is what gets said in writing. If this gets said in writing, what do you think gets said orally? There are two stages to the conditioning process. And incredibly, the home sellers, they don't understand it, and some of them never understand it. And some of them even actually go along with the process. The first stage being the activity. The real estate agent creates lots of activity so that the agent can then come back to you and say, oh, gee, the way the market is at the moment, well, I thought your house would be worth this, but the market is not telling us. Buyers, you'll know when you go out to see houses sometimes and you ask, how much is this house? Well, I don't know. It's up to the market to decide, as if this is some spirit around called market that's going to come along and just tell us what it's worth. The first part of the activity process is advertising. Advertising. oh, I'm going to show you some things about advertising that will just, you'll think, well, hang on, how come? I didn't realize this. Let me put it to you this way. Do you know how much advertising there is in real estate these days? There are pages and pages. The Sydney Morning Herald, I've heard that if you started to read the Sydney Morning Herald on a Saturday morning and read every word, it'd take you 3 weeks to finish it. So therefore, you could never actually read the whole thing. How much of it is real estate? How many in your local newspapers, how many advertisements are just real estate, page after page? It wasn't like this 10 or 20 years ago. So why has it increased so much? Why are real estate agents doing all this advertising? And in a boom, when they say they've got buyers everywhere, why are they advertising for buyers? Because they're not advertising for buyers. They're not advertising houses. They're advertising themselves, number one. And they are using it to condition the sellers by saying to the sellers, well, we advertised your house, it didn't sell, therefore it must be the price. And look at what gets taught. They call it profile. Agents, if you create massive profile and at the same time reduce your advertising costs, you're achieving massive profits for yourself and your agency. And this from a real estate textbook. We advertise to achieve many various things, but in all cases, the end result is the same. We're advertising our businesses. And this one, the more ads you have with your name on them, the more successful you will look. In fact, you'll often hear the line that if you want to choose a real estate agent, just have a look and see which real estate agent is doing the most advertising, and that's the real estate agent you should choose. Well, I'll show you in a second that the real estate agencies who are doing the most advertising are the real estate agencies that are most likely to be fleecing the greatest number of consumers. Why has real estate advertising exploded so much? Why is there today 10 times, at least 10 times as much real estate advertising being done as what was being done 10 or 20 years ago? And yet, the number of sales being made today are pretty much the same as they were 10 or 20 years ago. Who in this room here, and there'll be people here tonight that would have to advertise their businesses, and there'll be people here that are in marketing, people here that have got common sense. Can you tell me why you would increase your advertising spend by 10 or 20 times as much and the sales don't go up? Who would do that? And why would it be done? Well, let's go back to literature, huh? And I think it was Shakespeare who said, never he who spends so much as he who doesn't have to pay. Because the agents aren't paying. They've got a system called vendor paid advertising. And here's a course that's taught by a fellow from First National. How to get money from people up front. Dollars in your pocket. And what it is, with the sellers paying the cost of the advertising, the real estate agents go, wabba-dabba-doo, let's go. You need lots of ads, you know. The more ads, the more you tell, the more you'll sell. And they teach it. There's a fellow who calls himself Australia's most successful real estate agent and goes around the country giving courses and teaching at the institutes and seminars, big conferences. Here's what he says. If the seller is moving interstate, ask who is paying for the advertising. If it's being paid for by the company, bump up the overall cost of the advertising. And for those of you who are just making notes, I'll give you a minute if you want to write his name down. It's Tostevin. That's Tostevin. Why do I say this? Why do I name him? Why do I mention it? The first time I wrote a book, I didn't put people's names in it. So they said it was all unsubstantiated. So the second time I wrote a book, I put all their names in it. Then they throw bricks through my windows. You've heard that there's new real estate laws come in. Mm-hmm. Yeah, new real estate laws. And you know what? You maybe heard that it's safe and everything's fine now. Really? When the government wants to bring in new real estate laws, do you know who it talks to? The real estate industry. That's who it talks to. Which makes about as much sense as if Mr. Watkins, who's the police minister in New South Wales, if he wanted to clean up crime, he'd go out to Long Bay and consult with the prisoners. It makes about the same sense. Do you know that real estate agents today can earn a bigger percentage commission from the newspapers on the advertising money they collect than they can earn percentage-wise on the homes that they sell? Not many people knew that. In Victoria, God bless her, Christine Campbell, the Minister for Fair Trading there, she's banned it from February. Fantastic. Here in New South Wales, no. They consulted with the industry. They haven't banned it. The industry just have to tell you. So in other words, it's okay to rob you as long as we announce up front in the documents there in the fine print that we're going to rob you. I don't know, when I met with Christine Campbell in Victoria, what were the words that I used to persuade her? I used this analogy. I said, because domestic violence is a sort of like an issue with me, and I said, Miss Campbell, it's probably akin to a man calling his wife on the way home and saying, I'm going to beat you up when I get home, and that makes it legal. That's the same sort of thing. Look, in this document, I said in small print, it's in there. There it is, agent's disclosure statement, all right? No matter how hard, the principal acknowledges that the agent may be entitled to receive volume contract payments from particular suppliers. And it's not just advertising, by the way, it's all sorts of people. And the principal, which is you, agrees to the return. It's all one sentence. You know what it is? I asked somebody, it's just another word for kickbacks. And they even have deals between the lawyers. And the lawyers draw up deals between the real estate companies and the newspapers. In the event that the rebate scheme is not permissible as a result of any federal or state legislation which may be passed subsequent to this deed, then the parties will negotiate in good faith, the newspaper and the agents, good faith between them, as to how, if possible, any similar scheme will be administered in the future, like flying 30 or 40 of them overseas for a junket holiday or something like that. At whose expense? Your expense. So what I do is when I say to you, never pay any money to any real estate agent for any reason until such time as your home is sold and you're happy, the real estate industry doesn't like me saying that. When the North Shore Times sends out a notice to its real estate agent advertisers showing them what their rebates, they call it rebates, you know, they change the name of it, like they change the name whale killing to whale harvesting. And gambling, they change it to gaming, don't they? Look. This is it. Ads are not written to sell the advertised property, says the New South Wales Real Estate Institute. But I have a question for you, a really simple question. If advertising really was the cause of selling your home, why would you need a real estate agent? Why would you pay the real estate agent money to put an ad in the paper because the real estate agent says that'll bring you a buyer and then pay the real estate agent a commission? I believe that the advertising that goes on in real estate is probably the greatest hidden consumer con out there. It's mind-boggling how they could actually do it to you. Consider it this way. You are consumers of products. You buy products or services. Agents, turn your phones off. You buy products or services. That's what you do. When you go as a buyer to a real estate agent, what are you looking for? You're looking for a home for sale. If the agent hasn't got a home, you go to another agent. If you're a seller, you go to a real estate agent, what for? To find a buyer. The same way as if you go to the supermarket to get some milk or you go to the butcher shop to buy some meat. Can you imagine walking into the butcher shop and saying, look, grand final day is coming up soon. I'm going to have a barbecue, a few friends over. I want to order some meat. How much would you like? I'd like 50 T-bone steaks. And the butcher says, okay. Give us a check so I can put some ads in, see if I can find some cows. Oh, you'd laugh, ha ha, very funny. But that's what the real estate agent does. Give us a check so I can put some ads in to find some buyers for you. Excuse me, you're a real estate agent. Did you just open this morning? You don't have any buyers. And why should I have to go pay? Now, picture it this way with the butcher shop. You come back Friday before grand final, and you're there to pick up your meat, and the butcher says, nah, no meat. So what about the check I gave you for the advertising? No, mate, you've lost that. But hang on, I paid it. Now, the market, haven't you heard? There's been a drought. You've lost your money. We wouldn't tolerate it for an instant. And yet, we put up with it in real estate. Look, the New South Wales Institute ran this course, how to get vendor paid advertising. And they put a little thing out saying the extra money you make will pay for the cost of the course. And this from realestate.com that talks about, hey, at this price, you only need run vendor paid advertising over 25 weeks to get you 100% of your website investment. It means the next 6 months is just profit for you. And here's another one, another website thing. You will bill your clients at the retail rate, $49, and you'll be invoiced at the wholesale rate of $33. Time after time. And yet you're told, aren't you? You're told constantly. Oh, you've got to advertise your house. You've got to advertise it widely, all around the place. Because, why? We don't know where the buyers are coming from. And when I teach real estate agents, and let me just tell you this, my name is Neil Alfred Jenman. But over the last 10 years, the number of times real estate agents have called out to me, "But Neil," I said, "No, it's just Neil, thank you, or Neil Alfred, but not but Neil Jenman. Just Neil will do." They go, But Neil, we don't know where the buyers are coming from, so we have to advertise everywhere. Yeah, sure, like 875 million people on the internet, as if somebody in Islamabad's going to ring up, you know, dial up and say, "Rush me the house in Coogee." No, you don't know where they're coming from, agents. No, you don't. But you know where they're coming to. They're all coming to the area. So if you live in Rose Bay, you could plonk your real estate agents at the lights on New South Head Road, hang a sign around his neck and just say, "Honk if you're coming into the area to buy a house." But sometimes we get investors. No, the best buyers for a home are family home buyers who buy with their hearts. That's who it is. And I'll tell you something else, agents. When buyers come into the area to buy a home, where do they go? Where do they go? They go to real estate agents. Do they go to chemist shops and say, well, maybe they should. Maybe they should go into the chemist shop and get some Mercendol first with the headaches they're going to have to go through. The average buyer spends 85 days looking for a home. Wouldn't you think they're going to find your real estate office in that 85 days? They go, "Oh, yeah, right. Look, the Real Estate Institute of New South Wales says sellers might be alarmed to learn that the advertising they're paying for has a slim chance of selling their property. A slim chance." They just actually put that in writing. But never mind how real estate advertising is done to promote the real estate agents. Never mind how it's done because a lot of real estate agents get the kickbacks from it. What else does it do to your home when it's advertised out there to 3 or 4 million people in Sydney who don't want to buy it? What do you think it does in your local area when your house is advertised week after week? Do you know what happens? I'll tell you what happens. People start seeing it. And buyers, you can pick the houses that you can, well, something's wrong with them. The ones that have been advertised week after week after week. Now, never mind that fact, what else do real estate agents say and do? What do they do? And I can't help but show you some of these. Some of the things that they actually say and what the owners let them say. I've got one here, and what I've done is I've cut the top off I didn't want to embarrass the agent. And it says, oh, it's on. It's cut off here. You can see it clearly, can't you? Sometimes they don't cut it off on a slide. It doesn't matter. This company's been going 100 years, but look at their headline. "Cheating husband falls in love. Wife's mad as hell and says sell the house in 30 days. Charming stuff. What do you think this does? Well, let me tell you what they say. "This stunning $1 million hilltop mansion can now be your dream home for a fraction of its real worth." And they go on and on with all these words, you know, as if they're Tolstoy or something. And he's not an agent. He was a writer. But this is what they say. "My husband's left me, and so I must sell our family home. And it goes on and on. And then it gets really, you know, the only thing missing is the music. "As you stand on the large timber deck attached to the master bedroom, the views are even more spectacular. It makes you feel as if you're on the deck of a giant ocean liner, just sailing into the red and pink sunset. In better times, we've even slept and made love on this deck. Under a perfect starry night. Let me warn you, once you've done that, the mosquitoes will eat your life." No, I apologise for that last remark. It doesn't say anything about mosquitoes, and I would like to now make it quite official. I apologise to the Ray White organisation that have been going since 1902. Do you know, it's all just verbiage. They just don't know what to do. It's just part of the activity of the conditioning process. The other night, and I can only surmise that this is what must have happened, the real estate agent is sitting in his office typing up what he has to say on an ad that's got to go on the internet. And, you know, you would actually think, after years of advertising, that it would just flow out, but sometimes they just go, oh, and this real estate agent typed in the words, blah, blah, and must have hit the send key. Look at this. Blah, blah. That's the description. It actually appeared on the internet that way. Anyhow, what else do they do? What do they say? What do they say about your house sometimes? Have a look at some of the things that they say. You know, due to ill health, this home must be sold. I have to tell you something, sellers. If you're selling because of ill health or an unfortunate circumstances, never let the agent know that you're bleeding. Never let the buyers or anybody else know that you're bleeding. Nobody has the right to know your reason for selling. You're selling because you've just decided to sell. Due to ill health, this home must be sold. Yeah, the owners of this large home are committed elsewhere and need to sell. Ah, but hey, their loss is your gain. Amazing stuff. The retired owner has bought elsewhere and must sell quickly to meet personal deadlines. This property will be sacrificed. They like that word, sacrifice, don't they? Must be from the Sunday school days. Have a look at this one, though. June 2002, must be sold to finalise divorce. Mm-hmm. All bargain hunters with more than $1 million, in you come. Okay? But then have a look in September. Hello, it's the same house. It's still there after months of advertising. What's happening? Well, what does the ad say today? Buyer defaulted, owners half moved. Very funny. Yeah. First there was the divorce. Guess who didn't show up for the settlement and lost their deposit? That's right. The buyers disappeared. The contract was for $1.75 million and now you can get it all for let's not even bother trying to negotiate the same price we had before. We'll keep the buyer's deposit. We've got our commission and off we go. We'll tell them straight off the top what it is they can buy it for. But you see, one of the things that you must do before you choose an agent is you must mystery shop the agent. You must call up the real estate agent and ask them about the homes they've got for sale and see how they treat their current owners. Because as an indication, how they treat their current owners is an indication of how they're going to treat you. But week after week after week, let me show you what advertising does. And I'm not using specific homes that I hope are not in your area. These are some from Victoria, but it happens everywhere. Week one, $390,000. And what happens? By the time you get down to week eight, $300,000. What do you think people say when they see this? It turns the home into a lemon. Here's one that I thought was interesting. This is a place called Cranbourne, just outside Melbourne. Set on a lush 5 acres, only minutes from central Cranbourne. Week one, $425,000. There's a little star there, 5 acre property. Okay. What happens? Week four, $370,000. Mm-hmm. But have a look what happens by the time we get to week eight. It's still 370, but it's gone down to 4 acres. Which just shows that not only does advertising shrink your price, it shrinks your house. And then you'll get things like, yep, turns it into a lemon. And then you'll get things like, the law could say they mightn't be able to do this in writing anymore, but have a look at this. You know, price guide, 630 plus. Now, what on earth does that mean? Well, come the day of the auction, you see, what happens is, the reason that if you catch your agent doing this, do you know what the agent will say? When you want 700,000 and they put 630 plus, or they tell the buyers, come to the auction, you might get it for 630, the real estate agent will say, yeah, it'll get more buyers. And you know the two most common words that I hear after people have been through the real estate process, if only? Because think about this for a moment. First of all, how many buyers do you want for your house? One. Okay, if you want 700,000 and you tell buyers they might be able to get it for 630, what sort of price do you think the buyers will want to pay you? 630, you've got it. So it'll get more buyers, but at the wrong price. Consequently, the real estate agent will then say, but this is what the market is telling us. Well, you fool, you have been looking in the wrong market. If you want to sell a property for 700,000, the first thing you need is somebody that can afford to pay 700,000. In this case, what we have here is the reserve on the property was 695,000. Now, can you imagine if the petrol stations started advertising petrol at 75 cents plus? And there's a huge queue for petrol, and you wait in the queue for an hour and a half, and you get to the end of the queue and you get out and the Bowser says $1.10. And then you look at everybody else and their Bowsers are all at $1.10 too. And then you walk inside and you say to the bloke, excuse me, mate, you got a sign out there that says 75% plus, and you're talking $1.10 here. And the guy says, no, no, it's just designed to get business in the door. It's working, isn't it? Now, how long do you think the country would put up with that sort of thing? We wouldn't. But in real estate, oh, no, these sorts of things are okay. This happens in Sydney, but nobody's checked it. It's only just blown this weekend in Melbourne. Real estate agents now, they digitally doctor and change the photographs on advertisements. Okay? Here's an example. Okay? This is our agents of deception. Have a look at this. Okay? That's what the house actually looks like. Okay? With the power lines and all this sort of stuff. Okay? What do they do when the agents got to it? There you go. Take out the clouds for the Melbourne weather, add in a bit of Queensland sunshine. The grass looks a bit brown. Yeah, a bit of digital fertilizer will be okay. Take out the power lines, the whole lot. Can I tell you what this actually does? What you need to be doing is you need to be underselling your home as such. Because buyers, they actually did a study once that showed less than one buyer in 300 ever buys the house that they inquire about. You know why? Because they get so disappointed that the advertisement is nothing like what they actually see. I was speaking on the radio this morning about an English agent years and years ago who was famous for his honest but cheeky advertisements. Things like, the only reliable water supply in this dump is the rising damp. And people would go to his ads and think, oh, because the owners used to get a bit cranky, but at least the people who would come and look at the house were not disappointed. Do you know, they actually have awards for their advertising. They have awards, yeah? And you think about the amount of money. What's the awards for? The awards are for advertising. They have categories of advertising. Categories such as the above $2,000 or the above $5,000 or the above $10,000 that you rip from somebody. At a Real Estate Institute dinner in Victoria just about a year ago, the fellow who won the award for the above $6,000 category, the MC said, and now let me tell you about Larry. Larry's $6,000 campaign attracted 800 buyers to the house, and everybody cheered. Everybody clapped. Larry came up and got his certificate, which now says he can hang on the wall, says he's a certified thief. Goes back, all right? I have a question. Again, 800 buyers were attracted to this home. How many bought it? One less 800 is 799. How many houses are sold in that suburb each year? The answer, about 370. So this real estate agent shouldn't need to advertise for another 2 years. Got all the buyers now. But no, what'll happen is somebody else wants to sell in the next street, they'll go and get another $6,000 from that person, another $6,000 from that person, another $6,000 from that person. So I say, don't pay any money until such time as your home's sold and you're happy. Because if you do pay, or even if you sign something that says, the agent says, ah, look, you can pay us later. And then you don't pay, they've got ways of making you pay. Here's an advertisement in one of their journals for the agents. Stress-free debt collection agents. Yeah. Let us take the stress of debt collection away from your staff and place it in the hands of our professional collection agents. We'll go get the unpaid advertising for you and the auction expenses. Or this one. This was a fax that was sent out. Agents, we know how frustrating, costly, and time-consuming collecting advertising debts can be. Your staff spend ages chasing reluctant homeowners whose properties haven't sold. Well, now we've got a special plan just for agents, especially for those hard case sellers. You know, those ones that have heard Genman talk and don't want to pay you anymore. Look, this is the message. If advertising sells your home, why do you need a real estate agent? And in many cases, and I have no other way of saying this, and I say to the agents that I teach, I said, if you want to win the honesty and the trust of the people in your area, then you had better start telling them the truth. And the truth of the matter is that probably 90% of the homes that are sold in Australia would be better off being sold without the involvement of a real estate agent. You need to say to your real estate agent, show me something you're going to do for me that I couldn't do myself. In fact, I've got to say, and I respect these people, these are not agents that I've ever taught, I don't think, but I saw this ad in the North Shore Times recently, and I thought, yeah, good on them. They're advertising these three LJ Hooker offices. The buyer of your property is known to us right now, even before you put it up for sale. It is entirely likely that we know who the buyer is. Of course it's entirely likely, and of course that's the way it should be. So I say to you, don't sign anything with any agent who wants money up front, because real estate advertising is part of the conditioning process, and when your home gets advertised time after time after time, not only does the real estate agent then have the excuse to come to you and say, oh, but it hasn't sold and we've advertised it, but it actually damages the value of your home. The only people that should know your home's for sale are people who are likely to buy the home. Buyers. And how do you find the buyers? They come into the area. There's another method of conditioning. And this is a method that you probably know, that if you know anything about me, you'd know that I'm probably known for disliking this method. But this method, and it is just a conditioning method, this is a method where I believe that, and I know for a fact, that when somebody is selling a home, it's a very, very emotional thing. It's not just a financial thing. We talk a lot these days about first home buyers. What's the opposite to a first home buyer? What would the opposite be? And we don't talk about these people very much. I'll tell you the opposite of a first home buyer. It's a last time seller, somebody who is selling their home for the final time. I believe that when somebody's owned a home for 50 years, they're pretty emotional about that. I believe that somebody should sit down and talk to them. In fact, many cases you can say to them, look, you're probably better off staying in your home if you can get somebody to do the maintenance for you. Maybe the Commonwealth Bank's now got a reverse mortgage thing. Maybe you could spend some of that. Oh, but it won't be anything left to leave to my relatives. Well, so, if you don't enjoy, what's the old saying? If you don't fly first class, your relatives will. Okay, so maybe you should stay there for a little while, but whatever it is, you need somebody to sit down and talk to you nicely. If you're buying your first home, you need somebody that'll sit down and take a little bit of time. But instead, there's a method which they say is increasing in popularity. No, it's increasing in deception and tricks, but there's a method that real estate agents use when people are making that vital decision, and it's a method where they get a man, and they put a hammer in this man's hand, and they get him to yell at people. Mm-hmm. It's called auction. Can you actually believe? I saw on location the other night, I saw the buyers sitting in the gutter. They're making the biggest financial purchase of their lives, they're actually sitting in the gutter. Yeah, we put up with it. These people. And what's the public words that we're told by the real estate institutes? Yeah, the auction process is the best sales process for houses. That's what we're told publicly. Mm-hmm. What are we told privately? When we're at auction school? Mm-hmm. Auction is the fastest and best conditioning method, agents. And that's a manual from the Real Estate Institute of Australia. You know, people say, you don't believe me? Look at it. Look how it goes. Being nice to sellers about the price they want won't get results. At least 3 letters, 3 office meetings, 10 telephone calls, and it's like stalking, isn't it? And 6 home visits will condition the sellers. And this, which wouldn't apply in New South Wales because this comes from Queensland. I know they're a little rougher in Queensland. And the fellow sent me a legal letter about this and said, look, you know, and I said, look, I'll stop talking about it if you stop doing it. Like, I remember, you know, if you stop telling lies about me, I'll stop telling the truth about you. So anyway, this is what he teaches at the TAFE College about auctions. Auctions, sometimes it's good to give the owner a kick in the guts. Yeah. Mr. Don Power, licensed, very respected, his solicitor reckons. Okay, well, stop saying that, Don. Yeah. The conditioning process must start early. Like we said, it's no good telling them the bad news the day before the auction. And you remember earlier I told you about that fellow Tostevin that calls himself the most successful agent in Australia, the one who says if the company's paying for the cost of the advertising, bump it up. Remember him? Mm-hmm. Teaches about auctions too because he loves the auctions. I'm not saying that all people who do auctions are rogues. What I am saying is that all the rogues seem to do auctions. Actually, I like that. I haven't said that before, but I like that one. I have to remember that. This is what Mr. Tostevin says. Always tell sellers that offers prior to auction are lower than they actually are. This is what he teaches. Mm-hmm. Now, he's actually, because he's so successful, he's also quite a good teacher, so he actually spells it out. And he goes on and says, if you get an offer before the auction of $270,000, tell the owners that you've got an offer of $250,000. Okay. Now, let me be clear here. Mr. Tostevin doesn't intend to steal the $20,000. That's not the case at all. What happens is the owner has probably been told that they're going to get $300,000 or $320,000. The offer, the house is probably worth about $280,000, $290,000, maybe $300,000. There's an offer of $270,000. In order to condition the sellers, you tell them $250,000. That's the way it works. I actually say to agents, and one of the things that you've got to try and do with anybody, whether it's your employees or employer or your children, if you want to convince somebody to do something, you've got to show them what's in it for them. And I say to agents, I say, agents, if you stop doing auctions, I'll give you one very good advantage. You'll be able to go shopping in the area that you work. You won't have to worry about seeing your customers in the supermarket aisle and having to do U-turns with your trolley to try and get away from them. I, people say I have to be careful. You know, don't we? It's such an intimidatory world today. Ooh, be careful. We all live in perpetual fear, don't we? Well, sometimes I think, you know, and next thing comes from a training manual, and the fellow who wrote the training manual, the book, he went on to become the training officer for one of the largest real estate networks, and they're a very big real estate network. So rather than give you their names, I'll just give you their initial. It was L.J. Hooker. And people, you see, are nervous at auctions. And this is what he wrote in his manual. Agents, it's your job to wander around and keep them nervous. That's what it is. Well, you're here, did you bring your checkbook, hey? Looking forward, everything going to be, oh, well, we've got a few people come. Your job to keep them nervous. Keep, oh, look, this one hasn't turned up. Oh, I'm not sure what that one's there for. Oh, I don't know if we're going to get the price today. Look, we've only got a couple of seconds, we'll have to make up your mind. Keep them nervous. Anyway, let's forget all that for a moment, because I think you've all seen that. I think we all kind of know that that sort of thing goes on. I think we've all seen young men with that, young men in their 20s, chewing the earlobes of elderly folk in their 70s and 80s, and you want to go and grab them by the back of the neck and say, listen, don't you speak to people like that. We've seen that sort of thing going on. But why do people continue to put their homes to auction? Well, I'll tell you why. Because they think it gets them the highest price. They think it gets them a good price. Well, I said there's three words to remember. If you just take three words away from here, it would be don't sign anything. But I'll give you four more. Auctions get lower prices. Now watch. These are the things that you are told. $41,000 above reserve. For this vendor, a Ray White auction was definitely the way to go. Okay. Auctions cannot possibly get you the highest price. The best the auctions can get you is the second highest price. They can get you a high price, but there is a difference between the high price and the highest price. There's a difference between a good price and the best price. The reason auctions can only get you ever the second best price is because the auction is based on what the second best bidder was offering. You see, each bidder gets to see what the other bidders are offering. So consequently, instead of paying what they've come along prepared to pay, they only bid one increment above the person below them. Watch this. Let's say that you're one buyer and I'm a buyer, and the most you can pay is 550, and the most I can pay is 500. That's it. Okay? We go to an auction, and the auction starts low. You know, 350, 400, and everybody says, oh, it's going up quickly. Well, of course it's going up quickly, because they started so low. It's like beating me up and saying, well, you'll feel better tomorrow, Neil. Yes, I will, I suppose. And as I start to climb up bloodied and battered from the platform here, see, look, it's better. The beating helped him. The auction goes up. It gets to 480,000. They say, oh, it's on the market. It's going to be sold. So you're bidding 481, 482, and it's going backwards and forwards. Okay? You bid 499. I bid 500. That's it. I cannot pay any more. That's it. What do you bid? 501. The auctioneer says, nobody else. That's fine. Sold to you for 501. Everybody claps, and then it's sold for 21,000 above reserve. They put the ads out, and you go, I'd have paid another 49,000 for that. It happens constantly. And any real estate agent that is doing auctions is either incompetent, which is not a dishonest thing to be incompetent. Lots of people are incompetent. We're all incompetent. There's a bit of Mr. Bean in all of us. I was washing my hands earlier. My tie actually went into the sink and it was just soaked. I thought, what am I going to do? So I've been dabbing it with. So we're all incompetent at times, aren't we? But any real estate agent who is auctioning homes is either incompetent or dishonest. Watch how it works. And I'll give you some examples. I'll take a property in Maroubra, in Hague Street, Maroubra. The reserve price, $850,000. Now, at every auction, there are three prices. There is the reserve price, which is the worst case scenario for the seller. That's the lowest the seller is prepared to accept. There's the price the property sold for, which is the second price. And the third price is the price the buyer was prepared to pay. The buyer's highest price. That's the seller's lowest price. What do you think they call the buyer's highest price in real estate? The seller's lowest price is called the reserve. What do you think the buyer's highest price is called? They don't even have a name for it. I told you they didn't study negotiation. So watch this. This property has a reserve price of $850,000. It sells for $1,015,000. Now the other question. What was the buyer prepared to pay? $1.5 million. The sellers lose $485,000 and never know about it. Now I heard, and it was coming from over here, a thought. The thought is,
how'd you know?
Okay. Well, aside from the fact that I've studied negotiation, I'll tell you how I knew in this particular case. The next door neighbour bought it. And the next door neighbour happened to be the Baptist church. And when the church wants to buy a property, it's not just one person making a decision. They sit down around a committee and work out what's the most they're prepared to pay. So the most they're prepared to pay is $1.5 million. They go to the auction. The reserve's $850,000. It's on the market. The person below them bids $1,010,000. They put their hand up. They don't have to say anything. They put their hand up. The auctioneer goes, and 15. Nobody else is bidding. It gets sold. Can I tell you, even if the church had put its hand up again, the auctioneer would have said, no, sir, I got that bid. They wouldn't have allowed you to pay your highest. And I proved this at a First National charity auction one night for the Kids First thing, because I'd like the Kids First charity. There was a bit of software, and I said to the agents I was sitting with at the table, I'll prove it. I'd like to pay $1,000 for this software. And the agent said, oh, it's only worth about $500 or $600. I said, but it's for a charity, and I'm going to show you. I'm prepared to pay $1,000. So the auctioneer started the bidding when it came around to this lot. It went $100, $150, $200. Somebody else, $250. I had it $300. Once, $300, twice. I went, no, $400. He said, oh, I've got your bid. I said, no, $400. He said, all right, $400,000. $400,000, any other bids? And I went, $500. He said, gentlemen, stop being a smart aleck. I said, 500's my bid. All right, sold to you for 500. Move to the next one. And I said to the agents, you see what happens? Oh, yeah, but you see it on TV, don't you? You see it, so like, look at this. What a fabulous program this was. Hey, and I have to hand it to Mr. Packer. You did well, sir. You are great when it comes to television. But I'll tell you something, I'll match you on real estate. Okay. With knowledge of real estate. 3 million people saw this, and they saw the winners were Fiona and Adam. And the reserve prices, we all knew, were $595,000. And that was very good and very ethical to actually reveal that. That's fine. Okay? Sold for $751,000. Adam and Fiona were the winners. What was the buyer prepared to pay? $800,000. Okay. $49,000. Okay. But the one... Oh, and then they start taking these ads. They had an unfair advantage. Ray White. No. The buyers had an unfair advantage. Auction. Because auction cost them $49,000. Oh, dear. I'm not allowed to advertise this sort of stuff, by the way. If I was to put ads in like this, they'd be banned. But let's move along and look at Warren and Gavin. Now, they'd have to have been the popular choice. Everybody liked Warren and Gavin. They had a reserve of $595,000. Their property sold for $670,000 to Crazy John, the mobile phone guy. Okay. And there they are, hugging Crazy John. Arms around each other. Isn't it just so touching? And I'm sure we were all touched at the time. Because if we followed the program all along the way, our emotions and our hearts were there too. But one thing none of us knew was in Crazy John's skyrocket, in his back pocket, Crazy John had another $330,000. Because Crazy John was prepared to pay $1 million. So the sellers lost $330,000 and never knew about it. And as somebody pointed out to me the other day, hang on, Neil, they also got $100,000 extra if they were the winners. So they're actually $430,000 down. Yep. I was down in Warrnambool. Warrnambool's a nice place. It's down in southern Victoria, and I was down there the other night, where a local councillor had bought a property in Geelong on behalf of somebody. Oh no, sorry, there's a Coogee property. Yeah, reserve 690, sold 690, buy as high as price 790, seller loses 100,000. It goes on and on. I actually did a study of a fellow who goes out free of charge helping buyers buy at auctions, by the way. And of the last 14 properties, the average amount that he's purchased them below what his instructions were to pay is $37,250. 14 properties, the total loss to the sellers of $521.5. Somebody says, but Neil, isn't that the market price? I said, is the market price the lowest the seller's prepared to pay or the highest the buyer's... Sorry, the lowest the seller's prepared to accept or the highest the buyer's prepared to pay? Which is the market price? Of course, it is the highest the buyer is prepared to pay. Anyway, this fellow from the Warrnambool Council buys a property in Geelong for $800,000. His highest price was $1.5 million. The sellers lost $700,000 and never knew it. Yeah, but Neil, what about Sotheby's and Christie's? Oh, really? Aren't they so respected? The Sotheby's CEO, or the chairman, I think he got out of jail last month in America. The Christie's chairman, if he sets foot in the United States, will be arrested by the FBI because he's known now as an international fugitive for the scams that they have. Listen, at real estate auctions, dummy bids come from passing cars, birds, and telegraph poles, okay? At Sotheby's and Christie's, they come from walls and chandeliers. That's how it works. Okay, well, forget the dummy bidding and all that sort of stuff, because I know, Neil, about a painting that just sold for some huge price at Sotheby's. It was a Rubens, and I know my artwork. Oh, really, do you? Do you mean this painting? This one that sold for 138 million? That's it? Yes, it sold for 138 million. No painting's ever sold for that much at auction, and Sotheby's hold the record. What was the buyer prepared to pay? 276 million. The sellers lose 138 million. Never know it, although they probably know it by now. And Sotheby's pick up a $16.7 million commission. Now, how would you have got the 276 million? Well, it's really quite simple. You don't let the buyers know what the other ones are offering. You just say, you've got one chance to tell me your best price, and that's it, it's going to be sold. Now, all of you here now know how to sell that Rubens painting. And I'll bet you'd do it, yes, for less than 16.7 million. You'd give them a discount. But you see, at auctions, when you're selling your house at auction, you don't know. It's not something you do every day. Some people only do it once in their lives. And what you've got is you've got people that have worked. I see people. I see them at airports. Some of the baggage lady at the airport the other day, she said, oh, I've got my house going for auction. And I'm thinking, what are you getting an hour? $18? And how much are you going to lose by going to auction? I nearly got arrested trying to stop her. You know? Because she's innocent and she gets financially massacred. And it's a funny thing about this world, how there are clues all around us. What's the name of this painting? This Rubens. What was it called? Well, it's a sign here from somewhere from heaven. It's called The Massacre of the Innocents. Yeah. So let's say you haven't realized and you haven't figured it out at this stage that auctions actually get lower prices. What you've got is you've got a situation whereby the pressure on you is starting to become intense at the end, and the pressure on them is starting to become intense, agents, and your persistency will win out in the end. Yes. But hang on. Hang on. What about the other thing that gets the prices up? Come on. Wink, wink. Hey, hey. They've got the new laws out now and there's no dummy bidding allowed. Hey, you know what the bride said the other day to his agent mates when they were doing the training? He said, I'll just have my dummy bidders register. Well, you see, it doesn't take them long to figure it out, does it? But you remember the headlines when there was a crackdown on dummy bidding? Oh, and this is, what did the real estate industry do? Well, this is what the real estate industry did. In New South Wales, the president of the Real Estate Institute, when dummy bidding first raised its ugly head publicly, he said, you like this, he said, I never heard of it. That's what he said. Mr. Hill said he'd not heard about the practice of dummy bidding before. There would be tricks of the trade out there, but I've never heard of dummy bidding. What's he do now, this fellow? He's now the president of the Real Estate Institute of Australia. They promoted him for that. Fantastic. What did they say in Victoria? Well, the CEO in Victoria said this. He said, I'm not sure what's meant by dummy bids. The announcer on ABC Radio said to him, explained it to him. He said, well, that's someone standing in the crowd pretending to be a real bidder, and they're not. What's his answer to that? Auctions have been around for a long time. Well, yes, so has domestic violence. And it would be more appropriate to compare auctions with domestic violence than it would be to try and say, well, because they've been around for a long time, that makes them respectable. Let me tell you about the dummy bidding thing. How do you have an auction if you only have one buyer? Isn't that cute, huh? We've only got one buyer. How do we have an auction? Well, you don't, do you? You just can't. A dummy bid is to an auction like a spark plug is to an engine. That's what it is. Agents have become so arrogant, and never mind this agent in the bathroom talking to his mates about how he's just going to register his dummy bidders. Agents have been paying dummy bidders to be in the crowd. Some agents got so cocky about it and so arrogant that they actually started to send invoices to the home sellers for the cost of having the dummy bidder in the crowd. No. I've got somebody's nodding here, but most of you are going, now I'll show you one from Victoria here. Look at this. Here was the invoice that went to the seller. Auction attendance, Ted, $25. Yeah. Auction attendance, Peter, $25. Because they're big, their name's Castor and Gilbert, and they're a very big agency, so they do it really well. You need more than one dummy bidder, don't you? And of course, auction attendance, Ron, he got $30. He must have made an extra bid, Ron. Oh, you mean vendor bidding. Oh, well, this is just Jenman being dramatic with this dummy, but vendor bidding, why didn't you say so? We change the name of it, won't we, quick. No, vendor bidding, no, a vendor bid is a legitimate bid made on behalf of the vendor to protect their interests, to stop them selling their property too low. And it's only ever made below the reserve price, so there's no harm done anyway. Time for the news now. That's all you're going to get. Unless you ask another question, then why don't you just start the bidding at the reserve price? Wouldn't that protect the seller? And you know what they'll say? You're not qualified in this state. You're not this. You've never worked in real estate. I'm the president of the Real Estate Institute. Okay, well, I'm going to tell you why they don't start the bidding at the reserve price, and there's two reasons, one that hurts buyers and one that hurts sellers. The reason they start the bidding below the reserve price is because they've been lying to the buyers about the price the property will sell for. So if they've been saying to the buyers, psst, come along, you might get it for $330, they can't go to the auction and say, well, this is an honest auction, the reserve's $500. So what they do is they start it at $330, it goes $330, $340, and the buyers go, oh, gee, the market, eh? And then when it stops at $470, the pressure goes on the elderly sellers to crunch them and sell it. So the reason they start below the reserve price with the sellers is because they fully intend to sell the property below the reserve price. Look what it says. You shouldn't worry if the reserve seems a little high, because when the bidding slows down, the reserve can be lowered immediately to the amount of the highest bid. This is teaching agents. This is Graham White, the fellow that was the LJ Hooker trainer. And this one. An owner cannot be forced to accept a bid below the reserve price unless they so agree during the auction. Whack, whack, whack. You know, please, please. And I say, if I had a wish, if there was one thing I could have as a wish in the real estate industry, it would be cooling off periods for all consumers. And I'm saying sellers and buyers are both consumers. All people